One of the most prolific rivers in America is the Colorado, and by far, the most famous site along it is the Hoover Dam, the tallest concrete arch dam in the United States. It's a symbol of the American response to struggle in the face of adversity. And although it cost over 100 workers their lives, America would be a different place, an arguably worse place, without it. Today we discover the history of Hoover Dam. I'm your host, Ryan Socash, and you're watching It's History. This story shows just how politically complicated the creation of Hoover Dam was, and how important access to information is, which is why I'd like to tell you a little bit about the sponsor of this video, Ground News. Ground News is an app and website that I frequently use to find sources for our content. It's an ideal solution because the platform makes it easy to compare news sources, read between the lines of media bias, and break free from algorithms. For example, Ground News offered a summary article where we learned how California water agencies rely on the parched Colorado River and can actually reduce use by one-tenth in 2023. We see that 62% of various sources are reported as center-leaning on the political spectrum and are mainly highly factual. The feature that I like most is that we can swipe through the headlines from left, center, and right-leaning bias sources and compare the language in the article headlines to see how the story is being reported by all sides. We can even click in and read each article from its original source to get the full picture. So stay fully informed on issues like this and more at ground.news/itshistory. Subscribe for unlimited access to media transparency, bias, blind spots, and comparative reporting coverage. The story of Hoover Dam starts in the southwestern United States, a notoriously dry region. Initially, the region was sparsely populated enough that its limited water supply could sustain its inhabitants. But as cities like Los Angeles and San Francisco grew during the late 19th and early 20th centuries, regional water became increasingly sparse. So naturally, the United States turned to the Colorado River, one of the largest natural sources of water in the region. You see, the Colorado River originates from La Poudre Pass Lake in the Rocky Mountains. It flows southwest for 1,450 miles through Colorado, Utah, New Mexico, Nevada, and Arizona, ending in California, where it drains into the Gulf of California in northern Mexico. Accordingly, it forms part of the border between the two nations, thus forming the region in more ways than one. Notably, erosion from the Colorado River is what created the Grand Canyon in Arizona. So when it came to a water shortage, surely it held the solution to those early settlers' plight. Still, even if it could quench one's thirst, the Colorado River itself posed many issues that burdened the growing population. Like all rivers, it flooded, often causing sweeping damage, such as the floods between 1905 and 1907, which drowned well over 100,000 acres of farmland in Southern California's Imperial Valley. It even left behind a lake, the Salton Sea, which has since seen better times. Hence, the Imperial Irrigation District eventually appealed to the government for aid in flood control after World War I, which wasn't the first time Washington acted on this issue. Seriously, as early as the 1890s, the United States began financing construction projects diverting the water of the Colorado River across the region. Among the earliest examples of this was the Alamo Canal, beginning construction in 1900 and opening in 1901. However, it should be mentioned that factors such as silting and a major breach led to the canal, contributing to the aforementioned floods that created the Salton Sea. Anyhow, the breach closed in early 1907, but the damage was already done. At that moment, the region set its course for the early 20th century. Flood control and irrigation to prevent something like this from ever happening again. In 1922, the states of Arizona, California, Colorado, Nevada, New Mexico, Utah, and Wyoming signed the Colorado River Compact, which defined water rights between the seven states within the Colorado River's drainage basin. It defines Colorado, Utah, Wyoming, New Mexico, and Arizona as the upper basin, and California, Arizona, and Nevada as the lower. Another provision of this compact involved federal investment into dams and reclamation. One of the first
big results of this was the Boulder Canyon Project Act, where the Bureau of Reclamation authorized the creation of a multi-purpose water storage project. This project, at the time known as Boulder Dam, had an estimated cost of $49 million, or $691 million in 2022. With a price tag this steep, support was initially underwhelming, but eventually, President Coolidge approved its construction. Initially, the planned location for the dam was Boulder Canyon, hence the name. However, after planners detected a major active fault in the proposed location, a new site had to be selected. That was to be Black Canyon, a little further downstream on the Nevada-Arizona border. However, for the time being, the name Boulder Dam stuck, though that name wouldn't last. Construction on the dam began in 1931, with a legion of workers blasting off the canyon walls to make room for hydraulic tunnels. These temporarily diverted the river flow so that they could build the dam without being flooded, and this was not the only challenge. As the high temperatures and the unventilated carbon monoxide threatened the workers' lives as much as the water did, the poor conditions and a wage cut led to a strike in August of 1931, but ended after 6 days with a promise against any further wage reductions. There was no improvement to conditions. It was a miserable workspace. The interior of the tunnels reached temperatures as high as 140 degrees Fahrenheit, and the heat almost killed one worker every 2 days in the summer of 1933. After the construction of these two tunnels finished, they established a temporary cofferdam, an enclosure made specifically for construction, consisting of rock and gravel from the materials they already excavated. The construction teams extracted four tunnels to divert the river, two on each side of the Nevada-Arizona border. 1932 saw the first successful diversion, using the two tunnels on the Arizona side as the main water routes, leaving the Nevada side for backups. A second cofferdam went up around the construction area using more debris, allowing the concrete pouring to begin in the summer of 1933. However, since there was so much concrete to pour, if they were to have poured it all at once, the dam would have been too weak to hold off any water. As the concrete is settled and cured, it contracts. And if the concrete is cured unevenly in the dam, it would crack and collapse. And that's to say nothing of the curing time, as the Bureau of Reclamation estimated the whole process could take over 100 years. As a result, the construction went piece by piece, creating sections with interlocking concrete blocks. Water pipes running through the blocks increased the speed of the concrete curing. The construction team poured grout into cement blocks, which is a mixture of water, cement, and sand, sealing it tight. After the team poured 2.5 million square meters of concrete, the dam was completed in the spring of 1935. I'd like to offer you just a little scale on how much material was used here. In total, the 6.6 million tons of concrete could pave a road from San Francisco to New York. It has 22,500 tons of supporting steel running through the concrete. Despite all these obscenely high numbers, Boulder Dam actually finished construction ahead of schedule. So I bet by now you're wondering why you never heard the dam's original name before, Boulder Dam. Well, on September the 30th, 1930, Secretary of the Interior Ray Lyman Wilbur dedicated the dam to President Herbert Hoover, and the name was made official by a congressional act on the 14th of February, 1931. However, Hoover became a quite controversial president due to his actions during the Great Depression, which, while meant to alleviate the strain of it, also brought the nation more harm. After he left office, some called to revert the dam to its previous name, but it never officially changed. In fact, in 1947, the name was reinforced. The dam itself went on to carry a stellar public image, but for President Hoover's reputation, you might say the game was rigged from the start. During the construction of Hoover Dam, Las Vegas lobbied very hard to become the headquarters for the construction. Concessions were made. You see, this was the era of Prohibition when the United States outlawed alcoholic beverages. So when decision makers, the Secretary of Interior Wilbur, came to inspect the city, local authorities managed to close down all of the speakeasies to better appeal to the federal government. Despite best efforts, Wilbur announced the creation of a completely new city directly next to the construction site that would serve as HQ. This city, Boulder City became the place where the Hoover Dam's many construction workers called home during the construction. Even so, Las Vegas didn't lose out entirely on this. A rail line joined Vegas and the dam site in the late 1930s, and due to the large influx of people coming from all across the western United States, Las Vegas's population increased from just 5,000 to upwards of 25,000. Coincidentally, this was also just around the time when the city administration legalized casino gambling. So who knows, if it wasn't for Hoover Dam, the Silver City may have never gotten her shine. Anyhow, the dam still attracts legions of people to the area. It's a major tourist attraction, drawing in 7 million people yearly. Travel is streamlined by US Route 93, which used to actually include a road across the top of the dam. While you can still drive across the top, it's no longer a part of Route 93, which now runs over a bypass bridge a bit south of the structure. And while you can still drive across the Hoover Dam, entry is from the Nevada side and there's no through traffic. This is logical, as ever since the 1960s, transportation officials saw the route over the top of the Hoover Dam as unfit for major traffic levels, and so they brainstormed plans up to the late 1990s, when they agreed upon the current bypass solution. The dam is an incredibly strong structure, but the pressure of the US highway tempted fate a bit too much for most officials' liking. Allow me to explain. The dam itself is solid concrete and steel. Below the road that runs across the top, there's just solid material. And that makes sense. If it was mostly hollow, it'd be easier to break. And as it stands, the canyon surrounding the Hoover Dam is more likely to break than the dam itself. Engineers estimate that the structure could last for well over 10,000 years without maintenance. Even in the event of a nuclear war, it's very likely that whatever survives in the Mojave Desert would find the dam standing. The dam holds river water within the man-made Lake Mead, and water began building in the reservoirs before the dam was even completed. Intake towers at the top rise and lower gates within the structure. Not unlike a canal, water goes through header intakes down large pipes called penstocks into the powerhouse, where the water operates 17 turbines to generate electricity and then flows through yet another set of penstocks into the outlet system, entering the river channel downstream. There are several systems in place in the event of an emergency to shut water out of the turbines and penstocks. For example, in June of 1998, a blast of water from the outlet system sent small waves down the Colorado River during new jet flow testing. The new outlet gates increased the released water capacity by 23,000 cubic feet per second. For reference, a cubic foot is about 7.5 gallons. 27 feet below the top of the dam holds two spillways, ready to take any more water if the water level got that high. These spillways are large enough to keep a battleship afloat, and as such, can take whatever extra water is needed out of the reservoir. They've only been used twice, once in 1941 during a test, and another time in 1983 after a flood. In all of its years of operation, the Hoover Dam has never once let water over the top of it, speaking volumes as to how well it was designed. Lake Mead itself is enormous. Its maximum capacity is 112 miles long and 532 feet deep at its lowest point. It is 1,229 feet above sea level with a surface area of 247 square miles. Its water capacity is a staggering 9 trillion gallons, which is enough water to submerge the entire state of Pennsylvania at 1 foot. It's also enough to store the entire flow of the Colorado River for 2 years. However, ever since the flood of 1983, increased water demand and drought have kept the reservoir below full capacity. In fact, as of 2022, the lake is at an all-time low at 1,042 feet above sea level and could drop below 1,000 feet as early as the summer of 2024. In response, the dam will decrease downstream water delivery by 4.44%, preserving more water for the region. And one more thing. Sharp-eyed viewers may notice that there are several buildings at the foot of the dam. Four stand out, two on either side of the Colorado. These are the Nevada and Arizona Power and Valve Houses. The powerhouses make up a massive and extremely powerful hydroelectric plant. Hoover Dam's hydroelectric facility was the largest in the world from 1939 to 1949, as 9 of its 10 generators were activated. The final generator came online in 1961, bringing the generating capacity to 1,345 megawatts. Later, 7 more generators came online, and since 1940, its minimum annual net generation is 2,648,224,700 kilowatt hours. A kilowatt hour is energy equal to 1 kilowatt of power acting for an hour, and a kilowatt is equivalent to 1.34 horsepower. That's a lot of horses. This energy goes all over the region, including Arizona and Nevada, obviously, but it also supplies many cities in California, most notably Los Angeles. Lastly, some might ask why the Hoover Dam is such a prevalent image in American media, which is not an easily answered question, as there are many aspects. So we'd like to point this out. It's a giant wall of concrete built against many factors. The arid surroundings, the working conditions, even the river itself stood in the way. And yet, in defiance of all that, one of the engineering marvels of the 20th century opened ahead of schedule, speaking to the spirit of America itself. Strength against adversity, banding together against situations imposed by man and nature alike to create something larger than life that will outlive us all. Perhaps recalling the notion found on most coins minted by the United States, E pluribus unum, out of many, one. Many people, many cultures, many ideas, struggles, sacrifice, and successes come one country. And from the many people who brought all of those to a canyon in Nevada, come one, Hoover Dam.